Thank you for your participation. Now, let's just quickly move on to our next discussion, this time on India-China relations in the backdrop of multilateral relations and multilateral fora. Noted scholar Andrew Scobell once spoke about the Chinese national security calculus and how the Chinese think when it comes to their national security. Andrew Scobell professed that the Chinese Communist Party think in terms of four concentric circles with respect to their national security. The centermost, innermost concentric ring consists of all the regions that China currently controls, followed by the outer ring, which would encompass its neighboring nations, followed by the third ring, which would encompass the South Asia and the Central Asia region, and the fourth ring comprising of the rest of the world. Now, India holds a very important position in Chinese national security calculus because it features on two rings, the second and the third ring, as a neighbor, a direct neighbor, and at the same time, part of the South Asian region. India and China, until recently, it was revealed that India and China have a very healthy bilateral trade relation that amounts to about $66 billion. This year, it's set to touch $100 billion, some experts say. That reminds me of another liberal theory, this time by Immanuel Kant, who spoke of the Kantian tripod. When Kant spoke of the Kantian tripod, he spoke about the need for perpetual peace, and there's one way to get there, by making sure that bilateral relations check out three criteria, hence the Kantian tripod. Number one, mutual affinity for democratic values, a healthy trade partnership, which today we see in the modern day image of liberalism and institutionalism, and third, participation in multilateral fora. Hence this topic for today. Again, this time I would ask Mr. Balachandran to chair the discussion, but before we open the floor for questions, I'd like to request Dr. George and Mr. Balachandran to give their opening remarks. Thank you.
Professor Zhang Jiwan, Dr. Jose, and assembled scholars. When Mr. Dhawal Desai called me, invited me to chair this, I said, I know nothing about economics, I know nothing about commerce. Why are you calling me? So he said, no, we want you to chair a session on the strategic implications of the multilateral relations between both countries. So since I know nothing of subject, the earlier one, whatever you discussed, I think it all went above my head. I hope I'll be able to do some justice to the second session. Regarding the Chinese, or rather Indo-Chinese relations on multilateral area, I would only like to quote the visit of Chinese President to India in September of 2014. And our Prime Minister's visit to China in May 2015, where they discussed various regional, multilateral, and global issues. And there was a willingness to strengthen coordination and cooperation in multilateral forums, including Russia, India, China, that is what is called RIC. A lot of abbreviations, RICs and BRICS and various things, you know. One has, I had to find out what is this RIC and other thing, because anyway. And to promote the interests of developing countries, India will support China in hosting the G20 summit in 2016. One thing very, very important which I found during the Prime Minister's visit to China, usually in all such high-level visits, the states are ignored. In this case, I found there was a particular mention that the Indian states and Chinese provinces have lead roles in advancing bilateral relationship. That, I must say, is something fundamentally different from all several such prime minister's visits or bilateral high-level visits. And I wonder whether there's any such mention. Say, for example, the prime minister goes to United States. Was there anything, the direct relationship between provinces and others? Of course, in fact, de facto, I know that the states Indian states and American states have a relationship. For example, in Canada there is, the relationship is there. But invariably the practice is that you go through the government of India through protocol and all that. But this is something unique. The first meeting of the forum was held in Beijing on 15 May with the participation of Prime Minister Modi and Premier Lee. Now, coming to specifically about BCIM, Bangladesh, China, India, Myanmar Economic Corridor, this will have a very, very serious security challenges. And this economic corridor will link Kolkata with Kunming, the capital of China's Yunnan province, passing through Myanmar and Bangladesh, with Mandalay and Dhaka among the focal points. A report in June this year, this is about the progress, said that the main artery of 2,800 kilometers, what is called K, Calcutta, and 2K is Kunming, corridor is nearly ready. A stretch of less than 200 kilometers from Kalewa to Monuava in Myanmar needs to be upgraded as an all-weather road. This corridor will provide access to the sea for our landlocked North Indian states. This will be a great thing if it is achieved. Lastly, I won't prolong my preliminary remarks. Similarly, the Chinese President's initiative in 2013, known as the 21st Century Maritime Silk Road, also called One Belt, One Road, OBOR, seeks to connect China with the Middle East, Africa, and Europe through Central Asia and the littoral states of Southeast Asia and South Asia. This is perhaps one of the most challenging program undertaken by the Chinese president, and I think it is very totally unprecedented. As a security analyst, I only hope if the political dialogue with the concerned states do not go hand in hand, and if you confine yourself only on economic or commercial interest, this may create some problem. This will be a very big challenge. Let us see what happened in Afghanistan. A few years before General Nasirullah, sorry for shifting to the security, a few years before General Nasirullah Babur, who was one of the closest aides of Benazir Bhutto, before he died, that is after the assassination of Benazir Bhutto, he said that this Turkmenistan, Karachi, or other Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan pipeline was thought conceived by Benazir in the early 90s in order to develop Afghanistan and to see that it creates jobs, industries, and also give energy to Pakistan and India. Mentioning of India was very important, coming as it does from General Nasirullah Babur. So this program was conceived sometime in the early 90s or middle 90s, but unfortunately, and in fact at that time, the Taliban was the escort for these convoys, which are trial convoys which are going. And Taliban was very much in the game. They also visited the United States. They wanted to continue this project, but unfortunately something happened politically because of somebody, something happened and the whole thing went off, and now Taliban has become a serious insurgency problem in Afghanistan and Pakistan. So I'm only trying to quote this example. I'm not a pessimist, I am an optimist, but when you have a very ambitious program like this covering various countries, we should have political dialogue. The second incident, or rather second example, is the Iran-Pakistan-India energy pipeline. There again, nothing has happened from the 90s except goodwill programs and other things. So we would like to hear from the Chinese delegates how, more than other things, the multilateral thing, how in One Belt, One Road, think, how do you intend to, how does the Chinese government intend to go about, and then we can have discussion. I think Dr. Professor George, would like to say something.
Mr. Pal Jantaran, chairperson of this session, Professor Shang Yuan, and friends. When Kashis contacted me, I am a last-minute substitution for a representative from the Department of Civics and Politics. I'm also not an expert in international relations, mainly deal with Indian politics. However, in general, as Kashish has told something to say, I say India-China relations in the context of BRICS. Economically, India and China found their enemies identified. It's the United States and European Union. And probably that's why he thought about having another counter, the BRICS. That is Russia, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. So their dominant role was there. And dominant role has to be counted. And that is why developing or close to the developed world, they came together and making a counter. So that economic dominance, that way we are trying to counter. And as Mr. Balchandran has mentioned, even though that platform is created, I feel that political dialogue is not taking place as such. China, we see that China wanted to settle all their boundaries. Most of the countries, they have succeeded. With India, its problem is there. And genuinely, both sides there may be. India has the memory of 1962. And China always talking about McMahon line, which is not acceptable to them, rightly. And somewhere, especially in a democratic country like India, I think settling these political issues always political casualty is there. I feel that India wanted to keep enmity with Pakistan, and next by China also. After it is a political question. Politics has to. And sometimes, whether it is one party, Congress or BJP, whenever they come, they cannot. And that is that in democracy, that sort of political constraints are there because opposition will take care of. That is why I feel that with Pakistan, military cannot surrender their upper hand. And political question also. Pakistan, Kashmir is a ticklish issue. So the political class did not want to solve that problem, because that entire campaign we lost. Same thing also with China also. But China, I feel that that sort of political compulsion every 5 years they have to face the electorate and those sort of that. I feel that they can afford to be much more, little more lenient in the sense that sometimes they are taking a tickle sheet like issuing a passport, not issuing a passport to Arunachal Pradesh. The long relation with India and China, why they make such an inconvenient thing. That feel like larger issues are there. For the time being, consider it as such there. Because politically, we can understand the thing. But that political dialogue can be strengthened. People to people's dialogue. Let us have more trade between India and China. Exchange of people, all these ideas. And gradually take people into confidence. Once Indian people is taken into confidence by Chinese take into confidence. And once that greater political dialogue takes place, economic that cooperation is take there, that these are small issues, somewhere we can settle, I think that. And where, according to me, as a political science student, the China can afford to be more liberal because our political compulsions are there. We cannot forget Pakistan or China. And China, that good intention we are seeing, they settled their boundaries with almost all other countries. India also, if they continue the dialogue, but if it is not possible to settle immediately, for the time being, keep it as such. Let political dialogue, other relations, other things will continue. And slowly that will help us in be good neighbor. And economically, for example, India and China is going to be future economic strength, political strength, everything. Instead of having a more trade with others, let us have exchange this one. And that context, the importance of this BRICS is very important. Countering the economic, political dominance and military power of the US dominant and Western Europe, this platform we have to create. And once it's coming up with a military strength also, that is a thing is there. So I think that platform is, but certain and Shanghai cooperation, this thing was made, but it has to be strengthened further. Strengthened power always, I used to that, BRIC brother can be more lenient. For some SAR conference, I feel that India can be more lenient, deal with whether what is Bhutan or Nepal or Sri Lanka. By that, why we want how, and we can be more lenient and settle the problem. Given the situation, China has surpassed, gone ahead, we like it or not, from Indian part. And no more economically they are ahead, even if some these things are. And militarily also. And militarily now India, and whatever they try, we have to be realistic. It's not a match to China. And both of them are having nuclear powerheads. So war is not a solution. War is not going to be settled there. In this context, I have more and more people-to-people relations, and that suspicion should be avoided. That is going to be strengthened in the future. So my point is that whatever he said about political dialogue, let it continue. And once other things come up, economy, and we have said that it's a big market we India is having. And America is a greater market because they are domestically, they have developed much beyond India. India still, our market is restricted to 15 or 20% of people. 80% of Indian people are outside the market practically. They are, we can say, at the subsistence level. India should have a larger policy of developing our own domestic market. By that, poverty eradication program should be there, in which is that things there. There are cooperation between China, India, and both are the same start, almost in end of 1940s, early 50s. China has to be able to learn much from China. And China also can help in the sense that how they tackled the poverty issue, other issues, how the rural issues has been tackled, democracy there. I mean, mutually, they have to learn a lot, future contact. For the time being, forget about our border dispute. Keep a low profile. Don't talk about that. Once people-to-people relation is coming up, more and more trade, more and more commerce. Now, always we have a danger now that the Chinese economy, devalued the Chinese currency, which also means that already Chinese goods are in the Indian market. So more and more Chinese goods may come into the Indian market because they can sell at a cheaper rate here because devaluation of money, and that is going to capture Indian market. That fear is there. But mutual agreement, some sort of agreement is there, this much they are going to import. On the other hand, they also encourage India to export more to the Chinese. And the future is between China and India, that is realistic, and help each other. I think that the right type of steps taken, international relations also. And in the long run, I mean, for example, China and India is, India has small, prestige like membership in the UN. It's a very prestigious for India. But that also countering there, and China is not going to lose much, just support Indian representation in UN. Because after all, India has such a bigger economy, bigger political thing, and such a large population. India is also saving the platform. Some sort of a right step taken by from Chinese side, Indian demand for UN, other things they have. Because after all, they decided to create a platform to counter the American domination, European domination, and that should be extended to the political level also. Political level have a platform, by that they can deal with that. And that is going to strengthen. So I feel that India and China have a long future too, if they decide to share between them. People-to-people relation has to be strengthened, political dialogue to continue. But economically, they should be helping each other. It's a good neighborly attitude. First, you are good neighbor, And once that is strengthened, they forget about that and larger interests. So for the growth of China and India, countering American or European domination is a must. And that BRICS in reality, that is going to ensure, now we can say that militarily American dominant system is a plural system can be heard. By that different powers, military, economic, other powers will prevail. The plurality of the world will, that is a guarantee for sustaining the world. By that nobody should get upper hand, whether America, China, or this. That's this platform, this entire, this European Union there, I think India and China has a long future to go, and this political dialogue, economic relations, people to people relations, more this thing, and that is going to strengthen the developing world much more. And I find that good future is there. By that some sort of a understand India's problem, China's problem, be practical. Practical mind. Politically, we may shout certain things, but after all, I mean, political democracy there. But if you personally meet Indian leaders for any party, they say that, and we know that in democracy, we are used to that. Political purpose, you have to shout certain things. Just like in parliament. Parliament, whenever the power law, in open discussion, they take a position. When they go to the committees, committee level, I mean, select committee, other committee, discuss a particular bill. Their old parliament members are very, I mean, they are realistic. They exchange video, they are realistic. But open position in parliament, they have to take a position. But other, that is, many of the bills are discussed, finally is coming to that. So that also, you don't worry about politically something else. But at bilateral discussion between the political leaders, that level, this can be there. So I think that is going to be the guarantee for a greater relation between India and for the world peace, world stand, that is going to be, that's only some of my views. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. George. We can now take questions.
Thanks, Chair. I want to start with the name of my colleagues. The two colleagues sitting beside me, in their names, you say Dong. In Chinese, Dong means East. So now, East. So the world is looking at East. And India and China are all in the East. So today we're sitting here to have a bilateral, we say, think tank to think tank dialogue. That's why we see the importance and the significance of the bilateral relations. And as I studied political science and international relations. So what is new in current world order is that not only bilateral but also multilateral platforms are emerging more and more important. And this doesn't mean that bilateral is not important anymore, just as the former experts that has recommended that India and China should work more together on the existing and emerging global governance and other important international organizations and other platforms. So that's why we're sitting here in this section talking about the importance of bilateral and multilateral cooperation. And my second point is that when we look at all these institutions internationally, globally, and regionally, we feel that a little bit confused. The world is so complex today. We see so many institutions, etc., so many platforms, and in Pacific Asia and in also including India, these areas, the importance is rising hugely. But we see like somehow the institutions are like spaghetti, a platform of spaghetti. And so this is the first point I like to make. I wrote a paper on this kind of a phenomenon last month. I see the economic situation in this areas is like a spaghetti, but the security institutions is quite in short. This is what we are talking about. There's a high demanding of more strategic and a security dialogue. But you see, last year in China, which is held the Asia Trust Asia Trust dialogue. Confidence building Vera. So we see there are already lots of efforts that are making in these areas of strategic cooperation, etc. Especially in this world of globalization, we are facing lots of challenge, which is really with uncertainty, with that is somehow out of our expectation. One example is that terrorism is somehow which is beyond our consideration and which is beyond our capability to fight for one single country. And this is somehow need collaboration among countries, especially for the very important players in the region. That is maybe our role to play, India and China. So I want to highlight one concept of connectivity. What we are doing today a lot, One Belt, One Road, and the BCM, etc. All these mechanisms are looking at creating somehow connectivity. If we cannot reach connectivity on the first hand, then it is hard to work together and fight against some very emerging challenges, such as the terrorism, I have said. So if we look at One Belt, One Road initiative and other regional cooperation initiatives that is launched by China, your first glance is not to be confused, to feel challenged. The first glance might be give a little bit trust and say what we could do together. If we studied this year the Russia, the WUFA declaration among the BRICS countries, you see that this year there are 77 common senses which are written on the WUFA declaration. Last time were 72, and 2 years before was 36. According to these numbers that we say that our common senses are becoming more and more. So this is a very good start to give up the first glance of distrust, mistrust, and to really work on the concrete issue areas and to figure out exactly what we could do together. There are lots of things that we could do together. It doesn't mean that we are different and it's hard to work together. It's not like this. It's a world with interdependence. It's a world demanding collaboration. Somehow, such as the issue of poverty. This is also somehow we could work together. Here, my first feel in Mumbai was, oh my God, it's an international city. Somehow, at certain corner of Mumbai, I feel I'm in Europe. I have this kind of feeling that here is so advanced, but also there are also some areas of poverty. The situation in China is a little bit similar. You see very mega city, advanced buildings, technology, but in the rural area, there are also some people which are living under poverty line. So in these areas, what exactly could India and China work together? It's not only talk about lots of population under poverty, but to say whether there are somehow model we could cooperate and to figure out is the high technology advancement in India really could benefit the rural people, the people under poverty line. The real situation is not really like this. I see there some debates here in Indian society to talk about, okay, you are doing high advanced technology innovation, etc., but how could this benefit really the people from the grassroots? And this is also the problem that we could work together. So strategically thinking is not to give an impression of a strategic fear, but to take somehow one step further and see the concrete things that could be done together. This is my point here, and also to talk about the people-to-people dialogue that have raised by the two experts from India, that yes, political dialogue is highly demanding. And what we are doing here today, we are somehow 1.5 track, and this is somehow between the people to people and the government to government. We are doing somehow in the middle, and we could pushing our policy advices forward, upward to the government, and we could also to share our opinions with the people, with the common people. And this is the another thing. And also the chair talked about the BCIM. Last month in August, in our institution, we have held a very very successful conference of BCIM. Chairman Kulkarni has was present at our conference. We have not only invited experts from the BCIM countries, we also invited experts from like Sri Lanka, etc. We are still open to other neighbor countries. I would always like to quote from my director, Professor Zhang Yuyan, that no country could be free, fully developed. Yes.
No country can be fully developed while its neighbor is now. To go forward is to go together.
Yeah, yeah. So to go forward is to go together. And for the some lots of confusions and the questions concerning the One Belt One Road, whether it's dominated by the China, etc. This is somehow there's no necessity to worry about. You see from the AIIB, the membership is open to almost everyone. And the Great Britain was the first European countries which has jumped out to say, oh, I want to join. This is somehow open. Also concerning the organization issues, logistic issues, other issues, also the how it will be, how it will run, etc. This is also open to the other countries. Would like to hear a lot from the great experience from member countries, also the non-member countries as well. So the first thing is to listen, and the second thing is to work together. Okay.
So regarding the bilateral and the multilateral economic cooperation, I would follow Dr. Renling's remarks. And in my view, I feel that with the cooperation between China and India, we can not only facilitate the bilateral cooperation, but facilitate the multilateral economic cooperation in the world as well. And I would like to express my idea on that topic in the perspective of One Belt, One Road strategy. As you know, OBOR is China's international strategy. And since it's issued in 2013, China's government, financial institutions, and enterprises have real intention to facilitate or participate this strategy. But recently, we are taking into consideration more and more about the potential risks about the One Belt, One Road. In my view, the key challenge for One Belt, One Road strategy is to how to control the risks, and not only the market risks, but also the political risks and national risks. So in my view, I think that maybe China and India could promote the financial cooperation to facilitate the regional economic cooperation. For example, you can see if China's enterprises invest abroad with a bilateral agreement, China's enterprises will face relatively high risks. You can see that case in many countries, just like Myanmar, Mexico, and Greece. Chinese enterprises are losing money in that area. But if China's enterprises make use of the multilateral financial institutions such as AIIB and the BRICS banks, and China's enterprises will reduce its risks. For example, if China's company want to enter the India market, as you know that up to now, there are some limits and the risks for China's enterprises. But if China's enterprises could apply a loan from the BRICS banks, it's much easier for it to enter the India market. So it's a good opportunity for China's investors to cooperate with the BRICS banks led by India. It's not the benefit for the China's and India's bilateral cooperation. It's also, it would be also enhance the India's global impact as well, because BRICS Bank is suggested by the Indian people and led by the Indian people. And as you know, China has China's enterprise has a lot of fund. They have strong intention to go abroad. If they can cooperate with BRICS banks, and it's a good opportunity for both. And on the other hand, you can see that there are many Chinese financial institutions who also have strong intention to invest abroad, and not only in the AIB, but also the policy bank in China, such as National Development Bank, China Import and Export Bank, and maybe you know that there is a fund, Silk Road Fund. All these financial institutions led by China, it is not a multilateral institution, it's only the China's institution. They still have a strong intention to cooperate with India, to cooperate with the BRICS banks led by India. So if India can make use of this opportunity to apply China's food fund to the world, it's a good opportunity for both China and India to facilitate our own bilateral cooperation and also promote the multilateral economic cooperation. Thank you.
I may just add one small perspective here. When we talk about India-China relations, bilateral relations, especially in the backdrop of multilateral global and regional fora, you're talking about BCIM. Yeah, we are talking about BCIM, we are talking about the One Belt, One Road, which is very ambitious and very challenging by themselves. But what can there be a new perspective that can go into the thinking? Like to break down the regional and the global partnerships or the platforms into much smaller city and province-specific partnerships. So for example, Mumbai and Shanghai have a sister city relationship. But mostly what we have seen that but for some cultural exchanges, they don't really have any meaning. So similarly with all the other sister city citizenship relationships that Mumbai enjoys with the other cities around the world. But maybe in terms of public transport, maybe in terms of housing, maybe in terms of other like storm, the water recycling, the sewage treatment and recycling. All of these are avenues where there are great partnership potentials, and maybe at the city level, and here we don't even really require much funding because the local bodies themselves are sufficiently funded internally to roll out certain joint exercises. Maybe what you need is some systemic checks and balances that will facilitate the implementation. So I would like your views, and especially we have Mr. Khatua here, who is heading a government initiative called the Mumbai Transformation Support Unit. And they are playing a very critical role in the development plan for Mumbai, which is to be implemented from around by the year end for the next 20 years, up to 2035. So I think in that context, we have the right time and the right opportunity to forge some workable partnerships.
There are also some small mini summit, such as city-to-city collaboration summit, etc., and also divided into very small sectors. There are discussions. I think some of the Indian institutes, think tanks, are participating, and maybe will more think tanks join this discussion. They are like at the civic level, think tank level, business level. So they named the think tank BRICS, business BRICS, and the civic BRICS, city to city, city BRICS, etc., like this. So I think the collaboration on the multilateral organizations are divided into small pieces, like you suggested already.
Yeah, in fact, KSU and Mumbai first are joined together to inform all of you, to host two events as a part of the India's presidency of BRICS next year. Around April, which is what we have suggested, for a cultural exchange, the contours of that which are being now discussed and will be finalized in due course in consultation with the Government of India. But the more important event we are proposing around July, which will be to focus on the city development and city challenges. And at that time, we would expect delegates, experts coming from these other BRICS countries and joining with Indian experts to debate, discuss, and explore the areas where cooperation and mutual help can be taken forward.
I think I'd like to make three or four points based on what you've said. See, number one on the OBOR. Let me start with China and India first, because I think you raised an important issue of trust. And I think that it has been moving in a positive direction, right? But I think we need to just understand why the case was, why the sensitivities are there, right? And sometimes, I don't know, but sometimes I like to say this to my Chinese friends, that it is a little bit like China-Japan relationship, right? A little bit like. No, wait. Because things that are sensitive to China with respect to Japan, India is sensitive to something like that with respect to China, even though it happened many, many decades ago, right? But the generation is changing, right? The generations are changing. The sensitivity is going down and becoming more pragmatic and, as the generations are changing. I'm not saying it's not changing. But your point is well taken that, we cannot hold on to those things, right? But it is changing. And sometimes what happens is we take things so seriously here in our media, and Chinese media doesn't even pick it up. China does, we often ask our Chinese scholar friends, did you see that? They were like, no, nothing happened there. But sometimes it is also because the defeated party, whether it was the 1960s, feels the pain a little bit more. So you're always a little bit more sensitive, right? That's number one. Number two, on OBOR, actually, I think maybe even the Chinese scholars and Chinese society maybe does not understand and recognize that in India, China holds a very high regard in terms of its achievements. Not a single sector of the economy, not a single policymaker, not a single think tank analyst, not a single business person, every minute of the day, they always compare themselves to China, just like as we would do to the US, right? China's been able to achieve this, we should do the same thing. China's been able to do this, we are benchmarking. So please understand that there is a very good recognition of the achievements, right? At the same time, with OBOR specifically, when we look at it from here, it's a great plan for China, right? And for China to conceive of it and ask everybody else to join, right? I mean, nothing wrong with the plan itself. There are some elements to it which are not, which are a little bit of which are slightly thorny. It doesn't derail anything, but we must recognize that the China-Pakistan economic corridor goes through Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, right? Number three, I've been saying things are changing. Mr. Balachandran is here, who's spent his life looking at both security issues and how civil society has reacted to it. But the new government is different. Look at the energy provided by President Xi Jinping and Prime Minister Modi. It is different. They are trying to give the rest of the country a lead to say, listen, it's okay. There are some parts of history, there are some parts of the modern economy where we don't meet, but the future is different. And the manifestation of that is your consulate in Mumbai itself is a very good example. Look at the initiative that they take in making sure that the Indian scholars and Chinese experts meet with each other. The consul general, the staff. Similarly, I hope that our embassy and our consulates in India, in China are doing the same thing. There is a push. there is a renewed amount of energy. You know, we are having many more meetings with China than there was ever possible. And because you've started to talk, now we can discuss many things. You can pose OBOR as something that is thing, and we must be able to give, participate in it. You can pose multilateral banks, and we should be able to say things. And as we understand each other's terminology, the language, we will be able to come to some kind of terms. Lastly, I think I just want to mention one thing. In many cases, there is a capacity constraint in India. And that happens both at the level of thinking and at the level of implementation. And I can tell you that you don't have to tell us about that. We complain loudly and protest loudly about that in our own country. We have a capacity constraint. So even though we have a sister city relationship, and actually ORM Mumbai has done so much work on cities and, you know, security and energy and railway systems and everything else. But when we were in Shanghai, we were told by the mayor's office, right, that we have a sister city relationship, but the mayor's office has been trying to work with Mumbai, but has not worked. There's a 250 people staff at the mayor's office, and here we have two people, something like that. So there is a genuine capacity constraint at some level. Same thing with think tanks. China Academy of Social Science has 3,500 researchers. ORF Mumbai and Gateway House combined is 50 people? 34? Okay. No, but same thing with implementation, that sometimes we cannot match the expectations. And there has to be an understanding, just like as I think some of the other countries in the past, with the US and Europe, Japan and some of the other, they've had an understanding that, yes, there's a multi-layered partnership of growth. And, you know, we have to find a way to all grow together, even though we are at different speeds and we have different constraints. But as long as we know that we're heading in the same direction. Trust me, we feel the capacity constraint much more here. And we would like to tell our own government about, we do tell our own government that this is a constraint. But it takes time. For AIIB and BRICS Bank, the negotiations happen so fast from the Chinese side. China's already started preparing for G20 presidency 2016. And you move fast, but maybe the think tanks here can't keep up either. You know, so there is some understanding which is required. You have to keep a place for slow cars and the fast cars on the highway, right? Both. As long as you don't bump into each other and you know that you're going in the same direction, I think that's the idea.
Cooperation. So United Nations General Assembly, the 70th session is going to begin very soon. So I just wanted a quick opinion on United Nations Security Council reforms. Where does China stand on that? Vis-a-vis, of course, India getting a permanent seat or not getting a permanent seat. Quick opinion on that.
Thank you, Owari, for having me here. Essentially, what we're talking about here is how the two countries who are going to be possibly number one and number four in the world economy by 2030 are going to train each other into those spots. Because what is happening right now, or what I've read so far, is that the number one current, the United States, is sort of hand-holding the next number one into its slot. It's both give and take, as Akshay was saying, that we have to understand that it's a highway where there are four lanes, not just two. And there is also a lane for the fire brigade to go along. Otherwise, you're going to have a serious issue. The hotline needs to exist. So essentially, that's how we need to understand and, I guess, work among the 1.5 diplomacy which we're engaging right now as to how the number nine right now is also be head into number four. It's all give and take. So that is what we need to understand in terms of perception management as well. Otherwise, it's a lot of hot air on the media, and everything which is being done behind the scenes gets stalled. So that's what I'm trying to understand, how we can move together in that direction.
May I draw attention to the opening remarks of our chairman, and also followed by Professor Jose. and they laid a great deal of emphasis on the defense front in order to ensure internal peace and in order to make progress on common projects of common interest. And so far as I can share, as a common citizen of India, about an average citizen's perception about Chinese approach on the defense matters and especially the border question, which was highlighted by Professor Jose right in the beginning, I would refer to the subject of Uyghur problems in the westernmost part of China, the Xinjiang problem, and which is essentially a problem of Islam and Muslims, about which the government of China has taken very effective steps in isolating that part of China and containing that problem very well, on the one hand. And yet for the last 50, 60 years, in the opinion of an average Indian, the government of China is far more tilted towards Pakistan, and very unreasonably so, in the opinion. So that is point one. And the second point is, with regard to the defense exercises that take place in the region of Ladakh, when President of China was sitting with Prime Minister Modi in Ahmedabad, on that very day, there was supposedly incursion into the Indian territory, and there were some hot messages that were exchanged between Ministry of Defense in India and PLA on the other side. So all this appears to confuse an average citizen like me about how we can make progress on the one hand with regard to problems of common interest, which Madam here highlighted, with regard to poverty and disease and education and technology and whatnot. And on the other hand, there is a great deal of anxiety felt in this country internally. I may also point out one more subject of maritime security. Probably our chairman will be more familiar because he has had the benefit of looking at problems from a very high level. The northernmost island in the chain of Andaman Nicobar Islands it flies Myanmar flag. But that island itself, Cocos Island, I think, Cocoa Island, the entire Cocoa Island, we have a naval base, Chinese naval base, you see, because somehow for Myanmar has given, handed over that island to China. And some time back, maybe a couple of years ago, the Chinese ambassador in India, he went to the press to say that state of Arunachal is part of China. And there was a bit of a, I would say, churning in the press as a result of that statement. Then, even talking about Sri Lanka, the Chinese submarines, and then the China has made inroads into the government of Maldives. So there is a road that is constructed through the Himalayas or Tibetan plateau to the port of Gwadar in Pakistan. So there is a feeling in India with some sections about a complete circling kind of a approach on the part of Chinese government in India. And we have our own internal problems of security of those small seven states east of Bangladesh. So all this put together, an average citizen like me does carry a sense of serious apprehension about how these two great future economies, how they can come together to really resolve their internal problems of progress. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for your frank comments or questions regarding the China-Indian bilateral relations, as well as the international relations concerning the two countries. The comments you made is regarding the how to say the circling of India. It's a common perception of Indian people. China is doing something to circling India, with a country like Bangladesh and Sri Lanka and maybe other countries. It's interesting. To be frank, this is the first time I hear this kind of comments and this kind of fears from India side. This is my first time. What I have been surrounded is this kind of fears in China. China is being circled by countries, by countries like the United States. The United States tries to build up a sort of allies with India, with Japan, and with some ASEAN countries to circle China, to block China's exit to the outside world. So it's quite interesting. This kind of arguments remind me of a sentence spoken by the late U.S. President Roosevelt. Is that the fear?
We have nothing to fear but fear itself.
Oh, yes. Yeah. That is
the famous utterance of President Roosevelt.
Yes, Roosevelt.
Yeah.
I think we fear something. You fear something, but the fear. I think it's artificial one, not a real one. It's I think China has no any intention to circle India. It's impossible. It's useless. For what? We can gain nothing from doing that. To circle India, what for? It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. What we want is to reap the gain from trade. This is what we hope. One Belt One Road initiative is a hot topic, not only in China but also in some areas in the world. What we want to expand the market size. We want to deepen up the division of labor, international division of labor, through which we can benefit from one another. So this is what we want. And one background of One Belt, One Road initiative is that China, together with other members, other countries of BRICS, are excluded from the most very important international negotiations, TPP and the TTIP. Both China and India are excluded from that negotiations. The United States, together with its allies, Japan, Europe, European countries, they are setting the new rule for the future game. This is the reality. So we want to make a difference. We want to make a difference. We want to, together with other countries relating related countries, economies calculate the number of one belt one road related countries. That's around 67 or 65. This is what we want. We want, to make a difference, to have a leverage, to negotiate with the United States, with its allies like Europe. That's why we visit. It's one reason for us to visit India, to seek opportunities to cooperate. Let's join together. To not set the international rule, but to make a difference, to voice our demands to the United States, the dominant nation of the current world. So this is the circling. When we talk about the bilateral relation between China and Pakistan. It's understandable. We have invited in Pakistan. We are keen on the construction of the so-called China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. Why? We need we depend so much. Yeah, we need access. We need access to the Indian Ocean. There is a dilemma. We call it Malacca dilemma. We are a quite big importer of crude oil, and 90% of China's imported crude oil, transported through the Malacca Strait. We heavily, depend on that route. So we need to diversify the risk. Diversify the potential risk. So that's why we try to find another substitute route, and Pakistan is one of our choice.
Port of Gwadar.
Yes, Gwadar. Yeah, the port of Gwadar. So this is the reason. This is the fundamental reason. And I think this kind of bilateral relations between China and Pakistan can benefit India in a way that, along with the investment in Pakistan, the Pakistan people will benefit, they will have a job, they will, gain some salaries, increase that will increase the salaries. And they will, have more access to the modern education, have more access, a bigger access to the world. So their horizon will be widened, and that area will be more, will be safer. So I think India will benefit from the economic prosperity of Pakistan. And maybe when I talked with Mr. Kulkarni when he visited Beijing, we had talk over that issue, and I totally agree with him that China-Pakistan economic corridor, can include India as a part of that program. And the corridor so China, India, and then Pakistan. That route will benefit the three countries. And he also suggests that there is a necessity for the three countries to create a platform, a summit, China, India, and Pakistan summit, tripartite summit, yearly summit. I think it's a really good idea. Yeah.
Will that happen?
When? Oh, well, you know, I as a think tank, as a leader of a Chinese think tank, we'll strongly, you know, be supportive of that idea. We'll, you know, advise our decision makers to do that. But you know, it's just the, you know, responsibility of a think tank. We just, you know, give ideas or expertise to them. Of course, eventually they will decide when to have that kind of tripartite summit. But I think personally, I think it's a good idea.
Professor, can I quickly ask a question? No. Can I add a question? Oh, you're not finished. I'm sorry.
Oh yeah, I'm sorry. It's a and regarding to the UN reform. Yeah, you raised that. You know. Unfortunately, you know, one of my colleagues who is a real expert on UN reform has not come this time. You, when you visit China, visit my institute, she will give you, I think, a perfect answer of this question. But I think we need to reform UN Security Council. And India, not only India, but also, you know, other countries like Brazil, Germany, and South Africa, you know, Group 4, you're right. I think we need to reform that. But the policy of Chinese government is quite clear on that. There are some principles to reform. I know, but I'm not you know, expert on that issue. There are many ways. There are many ways to reform it. And for example, India can be a permanent member of the Security Council, but without you know, veto power. This is one of the thinking.
Being a shark without teeth.
How about Japan? You know, it's not an issue regarding India only. It's regarding many other countries. So China, it's regarding the bilateral relations between China and Japan, and in the Brazil. I can understand your stance, and personally, I think India as a large country and its influence in the world is increasing rapidly. India cannot be excluded.
So, if there was a resolution in the UNSC, would China veto it?
It's,
or not veto?
I'm not sure. You know, it's a decision made by the government, but as a think tank, researcher, for the time being, what can I say is that India should have a position in that council, but. There are many choices, so it's a very complicated issue. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. The questions. Firstly, I just checked the headline of many newspapers when the Indian premier visited China. Before this. There's lots of media question, how much does China cherish the Sino-Indian relations? Actually, the media report is sometimes it's not enough and sometimes it's too much. So I agree with the expert that if we want a good communication, that media is a key factor that we need to pay attention to. And secondly, I also have never heard of your comments. I heard also like some academic voices in the journals, etc. I read that economically, the U.S. is trying to circle China with TPP, TTIP, etc. And securitily, the U.S. is using the strategic return to Pacific Asia, etc. And these are the main economic thoughts. And also some academic papers are also quoting that the U.S. is trying to use India to make its Pacific strategy function, etc. But my personal view is that India is an independent country. It has independent thoughts. So I expect India with independent foreign policies. Secondly, India and China are two big regional countries here in Asia. We have lots of things to do in Asia. Big countries means more responsibilities, especially now. In such an uncertain world, in such a world that the economic is going down and lots of uncertainties are rising, there are things that we need to do together as a regional power here. So I expect to hear more Indian voice concerning the regional issues, how to make the region develop, etc. I personally trust that India is a country really with independent thoughts on its own, not its own behalf, but also on the regional behalf. Big countries means to supply more public goods, not only to its own people, but also to the regional people, etc. And also the Pakistan, Sino-Pakistan corridor, it's the beginning or only one part of OBO, One Belt, One Road. It's a starting point. It's not separated from the OBO. So it never separate Indian from the OBO. So we start with this and then we expand. And India is definitely included in the One Belt, One Road initiative cooperation. This is my last point. Okay.
Actually, no. Let me just finish. Just on factual basis, it's a Department of Defense, U.S. Department of Defense paper. The String of Pearls is actually a United States Department of Defense research paper that has first started the idea of China encircling India through the ports.
Yeah, this is actually by a defense contractor, Bruce Allen Hamilton. They are the people who coined this String of Pearls. In fact, I had written a piece, and we have a center here called Nehru Center. They had three session seminar. I wrote the theme paper for that. This is about 2-3 years ago. So I had criticized this concept of String of Pearls, that it doesn't happen at all. Anyway, may I just intervene and just tell two stories, let me say. It is actually recorded. There is a man called, a US diplomat called Dennis Cooks. I used to know him very well. He has written a monumental two volumes. One is The Relationship Between the United States and Pakistan. First, he wrote India and United States from 1947, even pre-47, and then Pakistan also. In that, he has leaned heavily on the declassified US government records and said that United States at that time, after India won independence, wanted India to be the member of the Security Council. Nehru felt at that time, because of the size, because of the sacrifices done by the Chinese people who suffered a lot, and it's a huge country, much bigger than India. Nehru told the Americans, no, China should have the rightful place in the Security Council. This is something which is there in his book. Now, secondly, is about our, I was also in the government service, and we have said the same thing, that China is having close relationship with Pakistan. There is a man called, very famous American broadcaster journalist called the late Walter Cronkite. Walter Cronkite is the man who called President Sadat, and the whole Camp David Accord started with his one telephone call. Cronkite asked him, President Sadat, if you get invited by Jerusalem, would you like to go there? That was unthinkable, because here is a man who had fought Israel for several years, and then suddenly this question, you know, what happened was that Sadat felt that the Arabs were fighting to the last Egyptian. You know, there is a saying in English saying that you want to take hand over the responsibility to somebody else. That he felt that the Arabs were not doing any fighting. All the fighting was being done by the Egyptian. So their attitude was, Arabs will fight the Israeli to the last Egyptian. So he felt that this will not do. Our economy is completely going to dogs. So he felt, I believe, when he was overflying Suez, he said, this cannot go on. Our country cannot bleed for the entire Arab world. We have to have peace with Israel. And that was the time when Cronkite knew about it, and then he asked this. So Sadat said, yes, if I'm invited, I'll go. And then Cronkite moved the US government, President Carter was there, and he put pressure on Israeli embassy, and then the invitation went. It was unprecedented. And then he goes there. And then before he went there, a group of American journalists came. So he said, well, you have a special relationship with Israel. I want you to continue that. But consider us also. So coming back to this, I just want to tell this story that we in India keep on saying that China and Pakistan have a special relationship. We should tell them, continue, but have a relationship with us also.
Can I ask a question now?
I totally agree with your point of view concerning the China-Indian relations. Yes, you know, we have special relationship with Pakistan, and at the same time, it's not an obstacle for us to build up a very good relations with India. No. And there are some obstacles in front of us. For example, the visa. It's very, very difficult for us to get a visa to be here. Some of my colleagues who received the invitation from Indian side, and eventually they gave up their visit because of, you know, visa. That's what one thing I'd like to mention. The other thing is, you know, I have some business people, you know, who are my friends. They want to invest here in India, but you know, they told me that the environment, for business, Chinese investment here in India are not good enough. They confronted many you know obstacles, many you know distributions, discriminations from Indian side. So if you open your door to Chinese investors a little bit wider, and more and more Chinese investment will come here, and the people-to-people dialogue will be, you know, increased. So I think, you know, through the mutual investment, the enlargement of the contact between our two peoples, eventually the relationship between our two countries will be improved, greatly improved. So that's my suggestion. Yeah. So okay, time is flying. I'm sorry.
Firstly, forgive me for interrupting you twice. As for my question, spoke.
You have a question?
Yes, I do.
No.
No. One last question, if I may, with your permission. You spoke of the Malacca dilemma. A lot has been said about the Malacca dilemma, especially in the circles of academia. People who study the geopolitical balance of power between China and the United States. I want to know, as an academic who comes from the mainland, how serious is Malacca dilemma a consideration in the security calculus of Beijing? Because if I were to be a devil's advocate, forgive me, I'm just being a devil's advocate, a counter argument to Malacca dilemma could be the same as you said, you have nothing to fear but fear itself. How concrete do you think is Malacca's dilemma? Thank you.
Yes, Malacca dilemma can be risky. Can be risky. You know, we have to do something to prevent something, you know, harmful to China. So, although that kind of risk will eventually come true.
All right, so legitimate fear then. Indeed. All right, let's call it a day. As a vote of thanks, I'd request Sanchayan to please get the token of appreciations for our guests. Thank you everyone for joining us. Thank you for taking out the time, everyone on the panel.